nitrogenous compound. Now, that's all. Plant can do nothing, animal can do nothing. But there are forms, little forms of life, which can feed on this nitrogenous compound, and they can degrade this organic nitrogenous compound. And this process, it is known as ammonification. But I want to tell you why this is done. Why this is done? Because by degradation of this protein, it will form ammonia plus some other compound. Now, for these little forms, ammonia is not important. It do not carry out the reaction to produce ammonia. It want to have that other compound, which will enter in catabolic reaction, that is energy generating reaction. For that purpose, it does this reaction, right? So this is ammonification step, because ammonia is for the organism a side product. Now it is NH3. This little organism can do nothing about that. These are, when we talk, it is chemoheterotrophic organism, and it can do nothing more than this. So from organic matter, it is now once again in the NH3 form, inorganic nitrogen, right? And other forms of life can feed on this ammonia and can convert it into NO2, that is oxidized form. This is oxidation reaction, hydrogen removal, oxygen addition. It is oxidation reaction. From NO2, it is converted to NO3. In both the reaction, the organisms which are involved, they are chemolithotrophic group of organism, means those organisms that derive electrons for their electron transport chain from inorganic chemicals. So they are nitrifying bacteria. They utilize electron for ETC from this. Now NO3 is ultimately produced. This chemolithotrophic organism cannot do now anything of this NO3. So one more life can take the advantage of this, and under anaerobic condition, they utilize this NO3 for electron transport chain once again. Why? Because instead of oxygen, they utilize NO3 as a final electron acceptor and convert NO3 to reduced form NO2, still reduced form NO, still reduced form N2O, and from N2O to N2, which is once again atmospheric nitrogen back, and this is how completes nitrogen cycle. So one more option is, certain plants can also utilize NO3, as it is seen in the cycle, as a nitrogen source. And the reduction process, in which final electron acceptor is NO3, can also convert NO3 into ammonia by reduction. There are two options. It can generate N2 or it can generate ammonia. There are two options. So this is how the cycle is interwoven or interlinked. And if ammonia is regenerated, it can be easily taken up by the soil organic soil organisms or plants. Now you will learn about phosphorus cycle from my colleague Ami Purohit.
Thank you for showing a different angle of the reactions. Coming to the next is phosphorus cycle. Phosphorus is an important element of ATP, DNA, RNA, and it also forms phospholipids in cell membranes. A human body contains about 0.7 kilogram of phosphorus. Phosphorus is basically occurring in nature as a part of phosphates. Unlike other cycles, microorganisms do not oxidize or reduce phosphorus. It is merely a conversion of inorganic phosphorus to organic form and back to inorganic form. Or you can say a conversion of insoluble phosphorus to soluble and back to that. The transformation occurs as altering the solubility of inorganic compounds, mineralization of the organic compounds, and immobilization process. Let us have an overview of the phosphorus cycle. Phosphorus, which is present in the form of phosphates in the soil, is solubilized by nitric acid and H2SO4. The solubilized phosphorus is uptaken by plants. Plants are eaten up by the animals. When they both die out, the dead organic compounds composes of the organic phosphorus in the soil. They again represent as a form of organic phosphates in the soil. Moreover, the organic phosphates undergoes soil erosion, get dissolved, and becomes a part of marine phosphates. This marine phosphates get sedimented in the form of reservoir phosphate rocks at the depth of the marine environment. These phosphates are oftenly used for mining and manufacturing of fertilizers and detergents. The fertilizers are used by plants, so the phosphorus again passes to the plants, and the detergents are used by human beings. This fertilizers and phosphorus again undergoes soil erosion, whereby the phosphorus again enters the marine environment. Let us see each step. Phosphorus basically is present in the form of insoluble phosphates. These insoluble phosphates are solubilized by acids like nitrous acid and nitric acid, by nitrifying bacteria, and sulfuric acid produced by sulfur oxidizing bacteria. Thus, the insoluble phosphates get converted into soluble phosphates. This is a reaction which shows conversion of insoluble phosphates to soluble phosphates. It is oftenly carried out by organisms like Favobacterium and Bacillus. The next is mineralization of organic phosphorus, that is converting the organic phosphorus to the inorganic form, which is carried out by enzyme phosphatase either at low or high pH. It is occurring more rapid under thermophilic range, at neutral pH, and in soil which contains rich organic phosphorus. Enzyme phosphatase is oftenly secreted by organisms like Arthrobacter and Streptomyces. And the third form is immobilization, whereby the phosphorus is assimilated in the nucleic acid, phospholipids, and other protoplasmic substances. That is, the phosphorus is accumulated in non-utilizable forms of the elements. This was the general movement of the phosphorus from insoluble form to soluble form and then back to insoluble form. Coming to the next element is iron. Iron proteins are found in all living organisms. Iron cycle is just a conversion of ferrous ion to ferric ion in aerobic conditions and back to ferrous ion under anaerobic conditions. Let us have an overview of the iron cycle. The ferrous ion is converted to ferric ion under aerobic conditions, and the ferric ion is converted to ferrous ion back under anaerobic conditions. In spite of this, in between, magnetites are formed under aerobic and anaerobic conditions. Let us see the steps in detail. First is ion oxidation, that is conversion of ferrous ion to ferric ion, which normally is carried out by thiobacillus organism at 2 to 4.5 pH. This is a reaction which shows conversion of ferrous ion to ferric ions. The second is ion reduction, which normally occurs under anaerobic conditions, whereby Fe+3 is converted to Fe+2 by organisms like Bacillus and Clostridium. In spite of this, during ferric reductions and oxidations, magnetite and siderite are formed as the end products. The electrons required for this formation are supplied by ethanol and propanol. The humus containing iron compounds are often attacked by pseudomicrobium metallogenium organisms. They form ferric hydroxides which gets deposited coating the bacteria or in the form of filaments. Thus, organisms like pseudomicrobium and metallogenium forms filamentous iron oxides or coats the bacteria. This was the movement of the iron from Fe+2 to +3 and back to +2. Let us see these reactions from paraben.
Dear students, just now you learned about some convergence between iron oxidized form to iron reduced form. Here it is seen in your slide, that is, it is conversion between Fe+2 to Fe+3. When plus is more, it is oxidation reaction. Why this iron gets oxidized? It could be one reason. By this oxidation, the organism will derive electron to pass in electron transport chain. Now, this is the speciality of the organisms which are known as chemolithotrophic organism. Means litho means they utilize electron from inorganic sources. So electron is derived from this oxidation, it enters in ETC, the organism will generate energy by that, and these are known as ion oxidizers. The same reaction, that is oxidation reaction, is also utilized in order to get electron by photosynthetic organisms also. Now photosynthetic organism also oxidizes Fe+2, derives electron, and this electron continues photosynthetic cycles. Here there will be no generation of oxygen because it only generates when H2O is the electron donor. So this is not oxygenic photosynthesis, but this is anoxygenic photosynthesis. So oxidation reaction of Fe plus 2 for anoxygenic photosynthesis is also a possibility. Next is reduction of Fe plus 3 to Fe plus 2. Now when the organisms are such a class that they have to live in anaerobic condition, then they are evolved in such a way that their final electron acceptor is not oxygen, but it is Fe plus 3. So it will take up, Fe plus 3 will take up electron and it will convert it into Fe plus 2 reduced form. So this is anaerobic respiration, the reaction. The purpose is to derive energy by anaerobic respiration. Now you will learn about one more cycle once again from Ami Purohit.
Thank you. Our last element is sulfur cycle. Sulfur is a component of major proteins. A human body contains about 70 kg of sulfur. Sulfur cycle involves the conversion of elemental sulfur to sulfate in anaerobic conditions, to H2S under anaerobic conditions, and back to elemental sulfur. Let us have an overview of the sulfur cycle. The elemental sulfur is converted to thiosulfate, to sulfite, and to sulfate under aerobic conditions. This sulfate is assimilated in the form of proteins. These proteins undergo desulfuration under aerobic and anaerobic conditions both. Under aerobic conditions, it forms back sulfate, and under anaerobic conditions, it forms H2S. H2S again undergoes sulfide assimilation to form proteins. Moreover, the hydrogen sulfide reduces to form elemental sulfate. This is also a back reaction where elemental sulfate again is forming hydrogen sulfide. In spite of all this, sulfate is oftenly converted to H2S, that is known as disimilarity sulfate reduction. Chemolithotropic group of organism oftenly converts hydrogen sulfide to sulfate. So this is the general overview of the sulfur cycle. Let us see each step in detail. First of all, let us see how does the sulfur enter the atmosphere. It enters in the form of hydrogen sulfide during volcanic eruptions and decomposition, as sulfur dioxide during volcanic eruptions and fossils and fuel burning, and as sulfate from sea sprays. Sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere combines with oxygen to produce sulfur trioxide, which further reacts with water vapor molecule to form H2SO4. H2SO4 is carried on the water with the earth with the help of rain. This is known as acid rain, which is damaged for the plants, but an important step for sulfur cycle. This is the general reaction which shows conversion of elemental sulfur to H2SO4 as shown by Brayley and Trudenger. It is carried out by Thiobacillus thioxidans. Sulfate is assimilated in the plants in the form of sulfur containing amino acids and then into proteins. Moreover, sulfate may be reduced to hydrogen sulfide by soil microorganisms like desulfatomaculum as shown in the reactions. The reduced H2S, that is hydrogen sulfide, oftenly causes further decomposition and reduces elemental sulfur with the help of photosynthetic group of organisms like Bigetoa and Thiothrix. Thus, the elemental sulfur is again back in the atmosphere. Winogradsky column. It is a lab technique used for study of or cultivating of sulfur metabolizing bacteria, developed by Serge Winogradsky scientist. He used calcium sulfate, plant parts, mud and water, added them in a column and incubated the column at room temperature under sunlight. After a few days, he observed different color zones in the column. At the end of few days incubation, he came to a conclusion that after the incubation, sulfur metabolizing group of bacteria, that is the organisms of sulfur cycle, can be cultivated in laboratory. Thus, it is a laboratory technique for cultivation of organisms involved in sulfur cycle. What is the importance of sulfur cycle? Sulfate is an important source of sulfur for plants. H2SO4 balances soil pH. H2SO4 helps in phosphate solubilization. SO2 absorbs UV rays. And sulfur cycle offsets global warming by increasing the cloud cover and maintaining a cool temperature. Let us see a different angle of these reactions from my colleague.
next slide. Friends, just now you learned about sulfur cycle, in which you have studied about two terminology, rather one terminology, that is dissimilarity reaction, dissimilarity reduction. What is assimilation and what is dissimilation? Assimilation means to gather, to synthesize, right? And dissimilation means to generate energy. If the reaction is occurring for energy production, you will define it as a dissimilarity reaction. If it is for some incorporation or some anabolic reaction, synthetic reaction, it is assimilatory reaction. Now see here, it is a conversion of SO4 to H2S. Now this could happen in some organism which do not get oxygen as an ultimate electron acceptor for their electron transport chain. So this anaerobic organism utilizes, instead of oxygen, similar type of inorganic oxidized molecule is SO4. It converts by taking electron gradually to reduced form, that is H2S. Now when SO4 is utilized, it is known as sulfur respiration, and the reduced product, it is H2S. One more reaction is seen here in the slide. It is the utilization of H2S to derive electrons. Electron can be derived from Fe, electron can be derived from H2O, or electron can be derived from H2S. If it is derived from H2O, it would be oxygenic photosynthesis, because it would generate oxygen instead of here, as you see, instead of sulfur. So as here there is no oxygen generation, it is an oxygenic photosynthesis, right? So reaction for their own purpose. One more reaction you will be able to see in the next slide is previous slide. It is sulfur oxidation once again. In the first reaction, sulfur is oxidized by chemolithotropes. Same principle by